Belfast! You can see me, but I cannot see you. Kind of interesting. All right, well, thank you for coming to our session. It's been a fantastic one. I am really sorry that I'm not there. I have been on sick leave for much of this year, and I did not feel comfortable coming to the conference. But it's been fantastic, and I cannot thank you enough. I'm here to talk about my Marie Curie project that I'm doing with Rich Madwick, Zoocrete, and we're here to talk about the zooarchaeology of ancient Crete, bones, isotopes, and environment. Because of that sick leave, I thought I'd be right at the end of it, and I'm not. But I got some really cool new data to present for the first time here, so stay tuned. This is a large project where we're looking at animal remains from multiple sites on Crete. We're collaborating with James Whitley and Lawrence Todelin here at Cardiff University, as well as other Cretan zooarchaeologists like Dimitra Milanon, Valisia Izakidou, and project directors such as Athena Tsingarida and Donald Haggis. And I'm really thankful to everybody for these collaborations. And we got some good data to show you. So one of the questions that I want to talk about in this presentation is what's called the Agropastoral Debate. Dozens of articles were written about this by historians of ancient Greece and archaeologists of ancient Greece back in the 80s and 90s in particular, discussing about the nature of animal husbandry in the ancient Greek world, in the Bronze Age, in the Iron Age, in the Classical period, etc. Was it what people saw sort of in the early modern period, a lot of seasonal up and down movement of sheep and goats going to sort of the uplands in the summer and the lowlands in the winter, larger herds? Or was it something else, smaller herds attached to sort of agricultural land, things like that? And so there was a huge scholarly debate, and at the time there was no real answer for it. But now that we have the ability to do isotope analysis, we can start to, you know, poke away at what's going on with animal management in a more specific manner. On a large scale question about what's going on Crete, in the Bronze Age, most sites are dominated by sheep, and this changes after the Minoan period, and in the late second through the first millennium BCE, still it's either sheep or goat that dominates all the sites, but in the east, many sites are dominated now by goats. And in an earlier paper I published with Martin Finet, we connected this pattern in the Greek world to climate change. The climate gets drier at this time, and the eastern part of Greece and Crete, divided by mountains down the middle, gets about half the precipitation of the western part. And so that seems to be a likely explanation for the shift from sheep to goats at this time. But it's tough to get in at any more large picture detail on Crete, because most of these dots or emojis on this map really only represent a few hundred identified specimens at each site. So we can really only get a taxonomy. What species are there? We need to have larger assemblages to answer more specific questions, right? And so today we're going to zoom in on Azoria, a site in East Crete. It's a really important site because it was abandoned suddenly around 480 BCE. And so it represents an early polis, one of these early city-states. So we get this transition towards urbanism. And because it was abandoned suddenly, things are sort of locked in at one time across most of the site, sort of the 6th century, early 5th century BC. And so the site has been under excavation in two campaigns from 2002 to 2006. I joined the team 2013 until 2017, and it was a large-scale excavation. A number of structures across the site were uncovered by a team led by Professor Donald Haggis out of UNC Chapel Hill. And so it provides a really nice site to answer these kind of questions. Most of the site is dating to that late Archaic period, 6th century or the 5th, but there's also at the very top of the slope a tower from the Hellenistic period, 3rd, 2nd century BC. It was a military outpost at that time. There's a few other structures as well dating to that period that the soldiers might have used. And then there's also a period of activity from the proto-archaic period, so the late 8th through the 7th century BCE, and it's mostly represented by this proto-archaic building here, which we think of as a temple. It was covered over when the site was rebuilt in the late 7th century, and everything else was leveled to the bedrock, and then they built a series of terraces and the new archaic settlement, except for that one building which was just covered over and not built on top of. But the late archaic settlement includes several civic dining buildings, the communal dining building, the service building, the monumental civic building where the citizens would gather, and I think we have about seven houses that we've also excavated. So from my point of view, we can compare and contrast diet, what people are eating at houses versus at public feasts where the citizens would gather together, sacrificing animals, as we know from ancient Greek sources, and feasting together to bond in these new city-states. So what's going on with the animal population? I'm collaborating, with Dimitra Milina, Dimitra Mikhailidis, and Katerina Papiani, who are studying the marine specimens, the birds, and the micromammals. I'm focusing on the larger mammals, and I've studied 250,000 specimens so far, over 20,000 identifiable, more to come. But the taxonomy is very consistent. Lots of goats, that's what you see in dark green, followed by sheep in light green, then pigs in blue and cattle in yellow, in every single period that the site has a significant number of animal bones. Goats, goats, goats. And not just in every single period are they eating the same animals, but throughout all the spaces. Every single trench with at least 100 identifiable specimens has a very similar taxonomy of goats, followed by sheep, followed by pig, followed by cows. They're eating the same animals in these big citizen public feasts that they're eating at home. So yeah, we're looking at a lot of goats. The mortality of these animals, they're being slaughtered at the same ages, regardless of phase or period, regardless of where on the site. So they're eating the same kind of goats, same age of goats, followed by sheep, followed by pigs and cow, in public feasts and at home. And the mortality between sheep and goats seems to be similar and identical as well. The only difference I've been able to tell from sort of my hands-on analysis of these animal remains is butchery patterns. These middens outside of the communal dining building are filled with a higher proportion of butcher bones that were butchered with a cleaver, a chop through a bone, like these vertebrae here that are splitting the carcass in half, versus at houses where you get these knife slices left on bones. And in particular, these cleaver chops are showing up in consistent locations only through the vertebra, through specific zones at the hip and the shoulder, right? And so I suggest that these are professional butchers for these civic feasts, published on this in 2021. Now we're gonna talk about the biomolecular analyses, where we hope to get a little more detail of what's going on around the site. I'm not quite finished with these, but they're in progress, but we have enough to have some pretty cool data. We're looking at, with Taylor Hermes, we're doing ancient DNA. At Cardiff, we're doing carbon and nitrogen, as well as on the bone collagen, and then we're doing oxygen and carbon sequentially up and down the tooth, working with Sandra Niederbracht. And then the idea is sort of to do a step-by-step analysis, so do 5 sequential samples, run the plot, and then try to take up to 2 more where we model with Jesse Wolfhagen where the maximum and minimum oxygen peak are to get a kind of summer signature and winter signature for sampling strontium. At this point in time, I have most of the carbon-nitrogen data from about 40 specimens, and the first 5 of those samples from the oxygen-carbon from 50 specimens. So enough to actually start talking about something, right? So when we plot out the carbon and nitrogen from the bone collagen, it makes a lot of sense. Seriously, I know it doesn't right away, but let's take a look at it. Let's look at the proto-archaic phase first in purple. Almost all of them are to the upper left of this plan. And so what that's suggesting is a lower carbon value, which suggests more C3 plants. Perhaps these sheep and goat are browsing or grazing on agricultural lands. And a higher nitrogen value, which would suggest that it would suggest the same thing, because potentially these agricultural lands are manured, right? And so there's a statistically significant elevation in nitrogen and depletion in the carbon ratio in the proto-archaic period. This continues for sheep in the civic dining building dumps, but not for goats. So these sheep, again, seem to be mostly grazing on agricultural land, while the goats that are being raised are clearly differentiated, and they seem to be browsing a wider set of terrain, most likely, to include some C4 plants or with a higher carbon value. In the households, it seems to be similar with those goats. Both the sheep and goat matches that sort of lower nitrogen, higher carbon. So we're getting sort of a more differential set of browsing and grazing, which seems to be showing up as well in the Hellenistic period. So there's this progression that we just saw from upper left to lower right, which indicates that, you know, different assemblages in different periods are mapping out differently, showing that they're being managed differently, which is really cool, right? So we can now start to see, in addition to being butchered differently, at least the sheep from the civic dining building, civic dining buildings, are managed differently from the sheep from households. So, and also, since in the proto-archaic phase, it seems to be mostly public dining deposits that we have, that also seems to be similar for both the sheep and the goats. So there's some interesting patterns hidden in these carbon and nitrogen from bone collagen. When we get in more depth on this sort of sequential oxygen carbon from the enamel of the teeth, what we're looking at with the oxygen line and with the white open dots is seasonality. So at its highest point, it's summer, approximately, and at its lowest point, it's winter. The carbon, then, is talking about different kinds of plants that are being consumed during those seasons, and we can start to track this. And there's a few patterns that seem to be showing up here. For one, sometimes the oxygen and carbon correlate with one another, which I think would suggest that these animals are staying in the same location, and the plants are changing seasonally, and so there's a seasonal variation in what they're eating that matches with the oxygen. Another big group have an inverse correlation. So when the oxygen's going down, the carbon's going up. And Cheryl Makarevitz and others have published that this seems to be an example of this vertical transhumance that we're looking for. And about a third of the assemblage seems to match up with that. We also, though, get Why aren't you switching? We get a very steady carbon signature that does not change at all with the seasons of the years. So in this case, they're probably grazing on fodder, or consuming fodder. They're being fed the same thing that does not have any seasonal difference. As well, we sometimes get animals that have a partial correlation. So for part of the line, the oxygen's going up and the carbon's going up, and part of the line, something different's happening. Sometimes we have a partial inverse correlation, and as well, we get a whole range of other things where there's no idea, or there seems to be a delayed correlation or a delayed inverse correlation. So there's a lot of different animal husbandry patterns lurking within this. There's a lot of variability, but at the same time, it does seem like the inversely correlated animals, so those where the carbon is rising when the oxygen's falling, they seem to mostly, for the most part, they seem to match well with those sheep that are consumed in the civic dining building and with the proto-archaic assemblage, or those goats that are consumed in the civic dining building. So those seem to be where most of the seasonal transhumance is showing up, while the Hellenistic period and the households, it seems to not be inversely correlated, so they're not doing as much of this up-down movement. But mostly what I'm seeing throughout everything is variability. There's exceptions to everything, and some of these inverse correlations seem to be staggered, or they represent larger or smaller amplitudes, so variation between the carbon seasonally. As well, some have absolute higher carbon versus absolutely lower carbon. And so there's a ton of different categories that we could start subdividing this into, with each of these animals having its own life history and how it was managed. And so this actually matches better with what's been published throughout the Greek world. For example, four sheep and goat teeth have been published from Hellenistic Central Greece and Thessaly by Catherine Bishop and colleagues. And with just four teeth, they had four completely different management styles. Similarly, from Bronze Age Knossos, also on Crete, by Valisia Izakilu and colleagues, they published nine different teeth, and they had five different management strategies that they identified. And so that's what I'm seeing. Instead of just a few different management strategies lurking within these 50 teeth that have been run so far, there's got to be about 15 to 20 different management strategies that we could start looking at, with higher carbon values, lower carbon values, higher, less amplitude between them, inverse, etc. So a ton of variability. And what that does when you look at the agropastoral debate is, yeah, probably a bunch of animals are moving up and down, only about a third of them, but there's a whole lot more that's going on. Some are being pastured, some are being foddered. Some are grazing on agricultural land, it seems like, and some are pasturing more widely. And there's just a ton of different stuff that's happening within this assemblage. There's a lot of variability. It's not just one thing or another thing. It's a lot of different things. So that's where we stand now. If you have any questions, I'll see you on Zoom. Thank you.